This week on the Green Left News Podcast, the police violence at Disrupt Land Forces and councillor Sarah Hathway campaigns against weapons in Geelong. Hello and welcome to the latest episode of the Green Left News Podcast. My name's Isaac Nellist and I'm talking to you from Gadigal country in Sydney.
And I'm Riley Breen. I'm joining you from Wadjuk-Noongar land in Bulu, Perth.
And this week we're joined by Jordan, who's a Socialist Alliance member and activist involved in a whole bunch of different campaigns: housing justice, Palestine solidarity, public transport and climate issues. And he's also a Green Left journalist, and in particular takes lots of photos of rallies you might see on the Green Left Instagram. And Jordan's here with us this week to talk about the protests against the Land Forces Weapons Expo in NAR Melbourne, which took place on the week of September 11, and were met with very intense police repression and force. So there was thousands of police officers being deployed to crack down on anti-war and pro-Palestine protesters. So Jordan was involved in, was at the protest, and he's going to talk to us a bit about what that was like. So welcome to the podcast, Jordan.
Well, thank you for having me, Isaac and Riley. It's a pleasure to be with you. And I'd just like to quickly acknowledge, I am speaking to you and recording on the lands of the Wurundjeri Woiwurrung people of the Kulin Nations, whose lands were taken by force. I recognise that this always was and always will be Aboriginal land.
Yes, 100%. And Green Left pledges to stand with First Nations people campaigning for justice, sovereignty and land rights. And as I mentioned, I'm speaking from Gadigal country. I also just mentioned before we start that if you'd like to support this podcast or any of the work that Green Left does, you can head to greenleft.org.au /support. And its plans start from $5 a month and makes a massive difference to help us continue with this work. So on to our first topic. As I mentioned before, the Land Forces, Disrupt Land Forces protest took place last week. But I guess for people who haven't been following this as closely, what actually is the Land Forces Expo, and why was the protest organised this time around?
Yeah, so the Land Forces Expo was an enormous gathering of merchants of death, or, you know, weapons manufacturers. So it took place in NAR Melbourne at the Convention Exhibition Centre between the dates of September 11 and the 13th. At this exhibition, you had companies such as Elbit Systems, IAI, and various others who are currently fueling genocides in Palestine, as well as, you know, other genocides, some still ongoing, such as the genocide of Elam Tamils by the Sri Lankan government. You had this massive gathering of weapon producers in a context where the total global military expenditure exceeded more than $2.4 trillion last year, gathering in NAM to sort of make deals, form connections and partnerships, and go about what they called peaceful business in the most grotesque sort of use of that word I've ever heard. So in response to this, Disrupt Land Forces was organized. Now, Disrupt Land Forces was kind of a week-long series of actions which brought together a coalition of such of about 50 or so different activist collectives, some in NAR Melbourne, some from around the continent, who traveled to be here, and as part of Disrupt Land Forces, there were a series of heterogeneous, very diverse actions planned, with very different tactics and very different atmospheres. Perhaps the most prominent one that people will be seeing in the media would have been the Wednesday, which was the picket against land forces, which was a very serious, very militant action. There were also solemn, very serious rallies held with some very powerful anti-war, anti-military speakers, who also managed to excellently intertwine the anti-military movement with other social, political issues such as housing, such as healthcare, refugee justice, and so forth. Then we also had, you know, other sort of rallies and actions that were more geared around harrying and jostling and shaming, you know, delegates of the exhibition. And then to wrap up the week, I didn't personally attend it. I was a bit busy, but there was what was called a zombie rave, which was a bit more of a kind of a festival of the oppressed, I think, type action. So we had this plurality of tactics and actions on display, which is great, I think, you know, in a healthy movement. This is something that we need. So sort of all of these actions that kind of cohered around this Disrupt Land Forces Week had the goal of kind of, we wanted to encircle the Melbourne Exhibition Convention Centre and we wanted to bring it to a halt. I don't think we were quite successful in that goal, if I'm to be honest, primarily because of the immense police repression that we faced and the fact that they had erected these enormous barricades around the whole convention centre before we were able to actually get there. But we were very successful in disrupting the city, the CBD itself. We would have been impossible to miss, and we certainly brought a lot of eyes and attention to what was going on. I wouldn't say, you know, I wouldn't be too pessimistic and dismiss the week at all. That's, I hope, you know, listeners would know that it's not what I'm doing. It's kind of more like a critical reflection to say that it was overall a good intervention, but I think there is still much work to do in a broader, more comprehensive and far-reaching anti-military, anti-war movement that we still need to build. It's fantastic that we were able to get about 1,500, 2,000, maybe a little bit more or less. It was not the greatest environment for counting people, and the actions were obviously not all attended equally. But I would say that probably at the height of the Wednesday picket, we probably had about 2,000 people, and that's fantastic. However, the fact that we had that many people and weren't able to make the successful intervention that we set out to achieve is a sign that we do need to build a powerful anti-military, anti-war movement, because it would have been so much better to have 50,000 people or have 100,000 people out there to, you know, block this convention. And hopefully we will see, I don't think we'll get 50,000, but I hope that we will see a strong response at the Avalon Air Show in 2025, which is going to be between the dates of, I believe, the 25th to the 30th of March at Avalon Airport in Geelong. That's probably the next major action on the radar for, you know, building an anti-war, anti-military action movement.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right, Jordan, that you can't measure the success of an action like this purely on the objective outcome of, you know, what did you manage to disrupt? You and I actually first met on a Zoom ticket back in February, and I think, you know, by the same measure, we weren't successful in stopping workers. I've been on other Zoom pickets. We weren't always successful in stopping workers, but I wouldn't call any of those actions failures, because those actions give people the experience of organizing. And they give people the, you know, they, one of my comrades described it as leveling them up, you know, watching a group of humans leveling up. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you can't get to that mass movement stage without doing stuff like this and falling a bit short of your goal. You know, you don't go from zero to 50,000 people.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things you touched on was the police repression. Obviously, from afar, I think that's the thing or myself watching online saw the most of. And I think I saw a figure somewhere around $15 million spent on the policing of the expo, which is just absurd. Could you tell us a bit more about the police repression and the violence against the protesters?
Absolutely. And I'm also glad you brought up that Zim figure that we met on, because this was another striking example of the type of violence, maybe not at the same scale, that we saw at Disrupt Land Forces. And I would put that Zim picket and this Disrupt Land Forces together as part of a process in which we are learning and developing and anticipating with more experience and skill and wisdom as we build the movement. So to move on to your question, the repression was quite immense. For me, it's not surprising, because what happened, many, many in attendance were shocked and couldn't quite comprehend that the police would use this type of violence, these tactics and the weaponry on civilians. For me, it was kind of more about revealing the kernel of logic that lays at the core of the type of political institution that the police are, and the function that it plays within the state, particularly a nation state organized around the notion of Westphalian sovereignty. And hopefully it helps draw parallels to people's minds between that police officer they see in the street and, you know, paramilitaries and, you know, maybe it might seem a bit extreme, but you know, groups like the Janjaweed in Darfur, Sudan, are actually different in kind, maybe in degree, but not categorically different to police in liberal democracies such as Australia, the US, Canada, New Zealand, and so forth. To quickly give a rundown on the type of weapons that were used against us, you know, well, people were bashed with batons, people were punched, people were dragged and kicked, choked. There was a very cavalier use of OC spray. They've obviously got a major supply of that stuff because they were not shy using that. They also had OC pellets. So this is, if you think like an airsoft gun or a paint, if you've ever played paintball, it really sucks to get hit with those things, but that's just paint. This contained OC dust, so essentially capsicum spray dust when it hit you. And there were people throughout the crowd, and you could tell when they had been hit because they were covered in the stuff. You know, there were also flashbangs. I've never personally experienced flashbangs being used, which are quite disorientating, very loud. That caused quite a bit of panic among people when they went off right in the middle of us. Rubber bullets were used. One prominent photographer in Nam was hit in the ear, and he's actually, I think, missing a part of his ear now and had to go to hospital and required surgery. There were also, you know, horses were weaponized as protesters were trying to mobilize. They were using horses to block people off, and they were also kind of jostling the horses, which could have easily started trampling people, or even if a horse had stepped on a protester's foot, that would probably cause permanent damage and disability. They also they had these big shields, like plastic shields, big circle. They had I'm not quite sure what it was made of, but they had body armor, essentially. They were very heavily equipped for what was, for the most part, quite a peaceful protest. You know, they deployed all this and violence in response to us chanting, in response to us marching, in response to us waving flags and banners. We were met with OC spray, rubber bullets, flashbangs. this is, you know, disproportionate is perhaps inadequate to describe how irrational and over the top their violence was. They kind of complained and spoke as if we had pushed them to this as well, and type of victim blaming maneuver, but I don't think you would have found a single protester who actually wanted the police there in the first place. And yeah, just to touch on what was said before, I think the figure was $15 million was spent to protect this exhibition from protesters. They brought in thousands of police officers from rural Victoria and New South Wales, including New South Wales Port, which is, you know, the public order response team, sometimes called the riot cops. And these are these port officers are actually the people who, the units who unleashed horrible violence on protesters at weapon picket factories the last couple of months. And there was also a particularly egregious night at a Zim blockade at Port Melbourne where they brutalised protesters, and they deployed some of the weapons that we saw this week. So that's just a quick rundown on some of the police brutality. I might also just add the comment that you know, people did observe some of the police officers laughing and mocking us at the same time, so I think there's been a bit of a, I'd say a dialogue, but perhaps more of a debate about the role that police play in capitalist society. And some people would say that we shouldn't be too critical of police officers as individuals. Perhaps we can say, well, the function that a police officer plays socially is something we could be critical of. But I think actually evoking sort of Marx's call to the ruthless critique of all that exists, I think we actually do have to take on the question of subjectivity and the fact that these are people who have chosen to do this with their lives. They've chosen to mock us, they've chosen to find employment brutalizing protesters, protecting billion-dollar companies that commit genocides, that oppress and subjugate people all around the world. Whereas I think most of us would prefer that they do socially useful things such as clean toilets, provide food, you know, help us operate and construct public transportation and health infrastructure and so forth.
Yeah, very true. I heard from one of our kind of photographers who's been going to protests for decades that this is like one of the first times he's actually been, you know, scared of what the police are going to do, because, you know, as you described, so many crazy over-the-top weapons, rubber bullets, flashbangs, the OC spray, and obviously just the physical violence as well. And I guess the other thing is, like, it could be described as, you know, they're showcasing some of the weapons inside the expo, and they're also showcasing some of them outside, where they're saying, like, look how good these are at hurting protesters and shutting down dissent. So there's that kind of like double meaning of the weapons expo. And yeah, you mentioned earlier like how, you know, that there was a few, there was between 1,500 to 2,000 kind of varying at different points, and people would have been coming in and out throughout the day, and there's a few other events on as well. I think it's a few people have been drawing comparisons to the S11 blockade, which was back in 2000. It was actually also in Melbourne and on the pretty much the same days, where that was a similar kind of meeting of big corporations that was protested by anti-capitalist activists. I think the difference was that one did have had about 20,000 people. So, you know, the police couldn't use the same kind of tactics on such overwhelming numbers. So that's a kind of a interesting parallel to look back on how we can kind of grow the movement. But I just wanted to mention there was this actually, like, if you look at just the Australian kind of media, you'd think, oh, look, this is just protesters causing trouble. Like, that's the kind of way they've tried to portray it. But around the world, actually got picked up internationally, with people being quite like shocked at how brutal the police were, and also just the idea of holding a weapons convention in the middle of Melbourne, which is supposedly meant to be like a progressive cosmopolitan kind of city, and holding a weapons convention in the middle of a genocide. I mean, they, as you mentioned, some of the companies, Elbert Systems is one of them, is Israeli weapons companies, and a lot of the other companies would be involved in producing weapons and parts and machinery that's being used in Gaza. So yeah, Amnesty International has spoken up, lots of kind of civil rights groups have spoken up, and international media. But how has the Victorian Labor government kind of responded to what's happened? And I guess any comments on the media coverage in the corporate media in Australia?
Yeah, absolutely. I might just quickly touch on one thing though before I get into that. What we did see as well was the whole area around the exhibition centre and into the city, parts of the city, were made into a designated zone, which actually gave police, you know, special powers. In a sense, they gave themselves these horrible overreaching powers to search people, you know, on the spot, to make them remove face masks, to compel personal information from them that they wouldn't ordinarily have to give, without, you know, sort of committing any sort of indictable offence or anything like that. And they actually used this to harass us, even after many of us had sort of left for the day and went to go have lunch at a bar down the road, probably a kilometre or so away from the exhibition convention. Police actually tried to sort of raid that. They said they came in with a warrant, and protesters actually had to flee because we didn't want to get searched and harassed or detained simply for gathering and eating some lunch. It is interesting too, sort of move on to this. You know, they did choose to hold this convention in Melbourne, which is considered the protest capital of Australia. One of the main chants, in fact, that we heard on the day was "Melbourne is a protest town." You know, it was impossible to ignore that. So you do have to question some of the logic and the planning there. I think the coverage in the corporate, mainstream and conservative media sources in Australia have been pretty condemnatory, you know. They've been quite disgusting, actually. I'll come out there and make that harsh judgment. Some people say that this is showing that these outlets have no morality. However, I actually think it's far more accurate to say it's not that they don't have morality, it's that this is yet another moment where they have been revealed to be replete with morality. The morality of the ruling class, you know. Almost anything that we do from, like, in terms of climate or anti-military, blocking roads, or causing slight inconveniences, we're challenging the system. We're usually smeared. But this was particularly egregious. Among other things, we were described as violent. We're not the ones selling weapons. Erratic. We've been called ignorant. There was one particularly unbelievably disgraceful smear on us. I can't quite recall who it was or the exact wording. Isaac or Riley, one of you might know this off the top of your head. I think we were called like filthy, disgusting protesters or something like that. The sort of language that you hear regimes call the groups of people that they're genociding. You know, I was reminded of, you know, the Rwandan genocide and some of the reporting and descriptions that you hear, you know, from that time. I think all of this media response was really in a way to sort of ameliorate and to sort of sanitize what our state, what our government, and what these corporations operating, you know, on this continent are really up to. There was also reports of, you know, the police being appalled by our conduct, shocked, as if we were out of control. you know, Jacinda Allen was talking as if we were naughty children who needed to be scolded almost. You know, it was, that was quite a disgraceful press conference to witness from the state premier. And we've seen trite arguments bandied about our hypocrisy. You protesters say you're for peace, but defending yourself from OC spray and bullets and horses and peacefully blocking a weapons exhibition, that's not so peaceful, is it? you know, these tired canards about us really being the ones that are disrupting things and stopping people going about their day. And, you know, some of the, there were interviews in the media with some of the people in attendance, some of the people selling wares, who were saying, we just want to go about our peaceful business. There was also this really, you know, some of the media was a bit more sympathetic, but it didn't quite go beyond the point of doing like a false equivalence, saying that, oh, well, maybe both sides were a bit out of control. This is horrible false equivalence that we, because, you know, I mean, afterwards, protesters, we were throwing things and we did burn some bins and erect things to like barricades to protect ourselves. But on the whole, we had glitter, bubbles. There's a video around of a prominent activist within the movement being assaulted for blowing bubbles at a police officer. We threw some water, perhaps, water bombs filled with red dye. Some people threw fruit at the police, you know, and on the whole, I don't think protesters can be accused of being violent at all. We defended ourselves, but, you know, the media who were there capturing the footage have certainly distorted, what we were doing, in order to portray the police and the state as, you know, being in the right, peaceful, calm, rational, and largely trying to discredit what we were doing, and trying to thwart any sort of mass mobilization against the profiteering of weapons. And essentially, I think this goes hand in hand with what we see our government doing. You know, as we try to oppose the militarization of this society and the world, we have bipartisan support for the militarization of society. You have these arguments about, well, they try to disguise it as we need weapons for sovereign defense and we need to manufacture weapons for sovereign defense, even though they'll go and then sell components and then weapons to overseas. And they also try to portray weapons manufacturing as if it's just any other sort of business. They take any sort of qualitative appraisal out of it, as if you're selling a candy bar or, you know, a chocolate or something. And yet they, the government, doesn't treat industries like sex work, you know, with the same sort of open-minded approach. You know, the government will attack and criminalize sex work, but not selling and manufacturing weapons. There's also a certain hypocrisy there too. I mean, not that I'm advocating for this, but if someone was to sell someone else a gun, that would surely entail a very hefty and severe criminal conviction and prison sentence. I would say what they're manufacturing and selling is a lot more dangerous than a handgun. I do also want to touch on a point that you brought up, Isaac, about, you know, they were displaying what they had sort of on the streets as well as inside. I think there's a massive acknowledgement that the weapons that they used on us were disgraceful, and I don't see any sort of liberatory or positive or socially emancipatory potential for any of those weapons. I think we should be manufacturing things that are actually useful for everyday life, but surely the wares that were on display inside were far worse, more devastating. You know, the media response, by and large, and the government response has been deployed in order to protect the manufacture and selling of, you know, those weapons. A bit rambly.
No, not at all. And it's worth pointing out, I feel like I mentioned this on every podcast that we do, but that the Labor and Coalition are both working together to try and make Australia one of the top 10 weapons producing companies in the world. So, you know, they're clearly on the side of profiteering from war and genocide. I think the Labor Premier of Victoria said in a speech that hate will not win, or something along those lines, as if it's wrong to hate weapons companies when surely everyone should hate people who are making weapons to kill other people, who have no real way of defending against these insanely high-tech weapons that are used nowadays. So I guess that a few other things you mentioned briefly, the Avalon air show that's coming up. So that's going to be in March next year at Avalon Airport, which is kind of near it's near Geelong and Melbourne, kind of in between. So there's going to be protests against that. But the other shocking thing is that they've already said that they want to try and do land forces in Melbourne again in 2026. So clearly, you know,
like red rag to a bull.
Yeah, yeah. So they've clearly not been put off by the protests that they're claiming were so, you know, violent and scary. So that's another thing. If that goes ahead as the plan is currently to do it at the same time in 2 years' time, we'll obviously have to have another week of protests and an even bigger and better one. I think it's interesting as well the correlation with this. You know, the connections between the anti-war movement generally and the Palestine Solidarity Movement, which is approaching the 1 year anniversary of the start of this latest iteration of the genocide. So, you know, people have been out on the streets every week, particularly in Melbourne and Sydney, but there's also been so many other actions happening. And, you know, we've seen all these new networks built up, new activists like learn the ropes, organizing protests and pickets and everything in between. So as you said, as Riley was saying earlier, this is kind of like a training ground for people to work out how to resist these exploitative and destructive systems. So that's kind of all the questions that we had for you, Jordan. Was there any final comments you wanted to make before we move on to the next topic?
Yeah, actually, I would actually like to maybe just quickly talk about... So you've mentioned the confluence between the Palestine and this anti-war movement. I think also, just upon personal reflection, I'd like to sort of talk a little bit about the refugee justice movement and the confluence there as well. So after the chaos of the Wednesday picket, I found myself visiting the 24/7 refugee encampment that's happening at 808 Docklands outside the Department of Home Affairs, where refugees have now been sleeping and living for I think 65 days. After, you know, not having been given visas after 12 years of, you know, being in limbo. It was, you know, being there and talking with the people after that, there was just this profound juxtaposition in the atmosphere. It was actually very calm, peaceful and quiet, and we were eating curries. It was raining cold and just talking. And, you know, I was talking with some Ilam Tamils, and just reflecting that the struggle that these refugees face in their everyday life. You know, some of them talk about feeling like they've been here for 12 years but can't live, like they've got a boot on their neck, that they can't breathe, that they feel such pain in their bodies. Yet they don't think that the 64 or 65 days of sleeping rough outside the Department of Home Affairs is the root or the apotheosis of their struggle. They don't even necessarily think the 12 years of being in limbo without a visa is truly the cause of their suffering, although certainly that is a source of suffering, and they could actually go about rebuilding their lives and living with some peace and organize to have self-determination if that did happen, if they were granted visas. Really, so many still share stories and experiences of being in Sri Lanka and experiencing the genocide of Elam Tamils, of the deprivation they faced, of the fear, the subjugation and the oppression, the dispossession, the despoiling of their land, and all of that is tied to the industry that we saw protected this week, represented by land forces, in fact, exemplified by land forces. So when we talk about building an anti-military, anti-war movement, as Riley and I discussed, we're not just talking about a single action, we're talking about a massive extended process of multiple actions and learning and discussion. But we're also talking about multiple movements. We're talking about anti-genocide, we're talking about refugee rights, we are talking about Palestine solidarity and Palestinian liberation, we are talking about Rohingya genocide, we're talking about climate and ecological justice, we are talking about everyday life, healthcare, public transportation, education, cost of living. If they have $368 billion to spend on nuclear submarines, $15 million to spend on protecting an exhibition, millions and million dollars to have contracts with weapons manufacturers, then surely the state and federal government can actually do things like build public housing to tackle the housing crisis, and to actually meet the needs of everyday people. However, the fact that they don't do this, despite how obvious it is, leads to the conclusion that without a change in system, political, socio-economic system, without overcoming capitalism, I don't see us being successful or prevailing in any of these movements. I don't see us achieving justice, freedom, liberation for any of the billions and billions of people who are subjugated, dominated, oppressed, and suffer under capitalism, settler colonialism, and imperialism. So I'll end there just with that reflection that the suffering that is the result of something like land forces is so far-reaching and dispersed that it actually reaches into almost any sort of crisis or flaw or failure of capitalism. And so not only, when we build an anti-military, anti-war movement, this is also, I hope listeners would understand, a fight against capitalism.
I think that's a really good point to end on, Jordan. Thanks so much for joining us today. I just wanted to, before you head off, point out to listeners that if you're in Melbourne, Jordan is running in the local government elections coming up in a few weeks. Jordan, if you just wanted to mention what area and stuff you're running in and how people can find out more.
Absolutely. So I am running as a candidate in the local Marybeck council elections in the ward of Harmony Park, which is west side of Sydney Road in Coburg. If you wanted to find out more, you can go to the Socialist Alliance website, read about my candidature, and also please, if you are in the area, look at the other Socialist Alliance candidates who are running, Felix Dance in the Randazzo Ward, Jacob Andrewartha in Pentridge Ward, and Sue Bolton, the legendary Sue Bolton in, I can't quite recall how to pronounce it, it's a very long ward name.
We'll put a link in the description for people to find out about all of that. And hopefully we're going to have Sue on the podcast on the next episode. So people should stay tuned and keep an eye on your podcast feed for that interview as well. But yeah, thanks again, Jordan. We'll chat soon.
Thank you so much for having me, Isaac and Riley. We shall talk soon, no doubt.
So we've been talking about two socialist candidates in New South Wales for the upcoming local government elections over the past few episodes of the podcast. But this week we're going down to Victoria. For people who don't know, the Victorian local government elections are only a few weeks later, in early October. And so this week we're joined by the Socialist Alliance City of Geelong councillor, Sarah Hathway, who's running for re-election in the Corio ward. So welcome to the podcast, Sarah.
Thanks, Isaac.
So Corio, the area that you're running in, is one of the most disadvantaged suburbs in Victoria and potentially the country. And could you give us a bit of a background about the area of Corio? And I know you've been doing a lot of door knocking and letterboxing and talking to people in the community. So what have you kind of learnt through your campaign and your time on council as well?
Yeah, so Corio ward encompasses the suburbs of Norlane and Corio. And I think with recent, you know, those socioeconomic stats that come out every year, I think Norlane was considered to be one of the most disadvantaged suburbs in the state, and Corio wasn't too far behind. And certainly living out here myself over the last 7 years, so living in Norlane and then in Corio and door knocking over the last 2 months, there's a lot of real issues out here, like a lot of generational poverty, poor health, whether that's physical health, chronic health and disability issues, unemployment, low education, and all those kinds of things. Historically, this area has been predominantly public housing. A lot of that housing was built for the Ford factory workers going back a few decades. A lot of that housing is starting to be sold off now, but whether it's private rental or old Ministry of Housing stock, it's really run down. We're hearing from residents that they can't get basic maintenance. And when I say run down, I mean probably shouldn't be fit for human habitation, some of this housing. And we've actually been shocked about door knocking and letterboxing where we've just assumed no one's living in that house. And we've spoken to the next door neighbour and they're like, oh no, like so-and-so lives there in these really run-down properties. A lot of issues around safety, so people not feeling safe in their homes or feeling safe on the streets. There's a lot of vulnerability out here, and a lot of stories of people calling 000 in desperation, like seeking police or ambulance and no one showing up to help. And we've had residents regularly telling us the need to lie or even overstate issues to police to get police to come out and de-escalate like interpersonal violence situations. So that's pretty full on, and that's the story that gets told about the northern suburbs. There's a lot of negative stigma, and you feel that when you disclose your postcode and you feel immediately judged. But we're trying to balance that with the good news story, and that there is a lot of amazing work that's being done out here that is resident led out of necessity, because people have just been let down by all levels of government. So whether that's, you know, revitalizing public spaces or working in our neighborhood centers or volunteering through schools, there's such an amazing sense of community out here and people looking out for each other. And so we've been trying to get that story out there as well.
Yeah, awesome. And yeah, that sounds really good. And I imagine, you know, the council could play a bigger role in supporting some of those initiatives. So I think we'll talk about that in a little bit. But I just wanted to ask, going a little bit further into this cost of living crisis that we're all experiencing to varying degrees, and also the housing crisis, what impact has that had on people in the area?
Yeah, so we're like, if you have social housing right now or public housing, you're lucky, and people know that. And it doesn't matter how badly run down it is, like people are scared to rock the boat because they're worried if they push too much, they're out. We've got people in private rental saying that they're being priced out because the owner can't afford to maintain the property anymore and they're wanting to sell off. There's a lot of selling off of housing stock happening in Norlane and Corio at the moment. And they're looking around for other affordable private rentals and there are none. And this was like the last affordable area in Geelong. So people are scared because they know if they're priced out, there isn't anywhere else to go. And there's a lot of talk now about people moving even more into like regional and rural Victoria because they just can't afford anything in Geelong anymore. I guess the other thing that's really noticeable, both with like the housing bubble that we keep saying is going to burst, it's going to burst, and it's not, and the increased cost of construction materials and that kind of thing, is there's a lot of land banking going on. So you could drive down pretty much any street in Norlane and Corio and see multiple empty blocks, and they've been empty for a long time. There's a number of old public school sites, so I'm pretty sure under Kennett, all our schools were amalgamated out in the north, and there were a number of public primary and high school sites that were shut down. The schools were knocked down, and these are massive blocks of land that have gradually been sold off by the Department of Education to private developers and then just sat on for close to a decade with no development. Like, there's no housing being built. There's a very slow trickle, but again, that's contributing to the cost of rent and the cost of housing and everything going up too.
I guess so what kind of solutions are you putting to the council? What would you like to see a council do in this area?
Yeah, look, it's a very small part that we can play, but council can definitely play a role. So one small win for us, there was a medium-sized block of land, council-owned land in Corio that council officers were suggesting to sell privately. And I put up an alternative motion at a council meeting for council to retain that land and seek to partner with a registered housing association to build social housing. Obviously as socialists we want public housing and we acknowledge all the problems with social housing, but even a small win was still a win. And so there's a lot of these old blocks of council land, not just in the northern suburbs but across the city, and that's one tangible thing that council can be doing in this space, as well as really stepping up in the advocacy space. So council's really hamstrung in that we don't actually have the power right now to mandate to developers, if we're going to release this new housing estate to you for development, you must build 20% public or social housing. We don't have the power. It's all by negotiation. So there has been a somewhat of a campaign to get state government to implement mandatory inclusionary zoning, which would give councils the power to dictate by and lock in the contracts that these percentages have to be hit. But at the moment, it's all just kind of by good feeling and agreement that we get any social housing or public housing built in these new developments.
Housing is one area where, a lot of more funding and investment is needed from governments for, as you mentioned, public and social housing and wraparound kind of services as well. But one area where there's plenty of money going around is defence and military spending. So Geelong, for people who don't know, is the seat, the federal seat of the defence minister, Richard Marles, the Labor defence minister. And he's one of the ones pushing for Geelong to become a key defence manufacturing zone. We actually talked to last week to Steve O'Brien, who's running in the Newcastle seat, which is another area they're pushing for to become one of these defence manufacturing areas. So it's interesting to hear about the different contexts. But it's part of this push to make Australia one of the top 10 weapons producing countries. So could you explain kind of what some of the details around this plan is, and how are residents resisting?
Yeah, it's been real insidious at all levels of government. And just last night I went up to Melbourne to take part in one of the rallies as part of the Disrupt Land Forces week of protest. But last night we had a rally out front of Humwa Defence Headquarters on Bourke Street, Melbourne. And the rally was particularly targeted at Humwa Defence and Albert Systems. And for listeners that don't know, Albert Systems is an Israeli-owned defence manufacturing company. And they're partnering with Humwa Defence out at this new defence manufacturing precinct at Avalon Airport. And that's been, to use the term, you know, Richard Marshall's baby. He's, you know, been pushing this for a long time. I think he was out there a couple of weeks ago, cut the ribbon, officially opened. And this, it's huge. Like, this precinct out at Avalon Airport, it'll just keep growing. But Humwa Defence has received a $7 billion contract from the federal government to manufacture redbacks, or like armoured land vehicles, infantry vehicles. And there's a few other things happening there as well. And then at the old Ford factory site, so, you know, the heart of what Norlane and Corio was built around was manufacturing cars at the Ford factory. We've now got Morand, which is manufacturing parts for, I'm going to get the name wrong, but basically the planes that are dropping bombs on Gaza. I think the tail fins for these planes are being manufactured there at Morand.
F-35s.
Thank you. Yeah. F-35s. I'm like, I won't pretend I can remember that. And then there's been a real push in Geelong through different lobby groups. So City of Greater Geelong Council and the Geelong Manufacturing Council formed the Geelong Defence Alliance, and they put out this leaflet saying Geelong is defence ready because we want our piece of the defence money pie. And that's been going on for a long time. Like, I can find evidence of that going back to 2019, but I'm being told verbally that that was in the pipeline since Ford and Alcoa basically closed, I think, mid-2000s. And council's deep in it is the bizarre thing, because you would expect this sort of thing from federal government. But now the Victorian state government got exposed doing memorandums of understanding with Albert Systems and the Israeli defence minister. We know our universities are all complicit, so Deakin University is absolutely complicit. But for local council to be so invested in defence manufacturing, it's giving over $600,000 to a weapons expo or the Avalon Air Show in March 2025. And meanwhile, like, last year we had to have a campaign to save libraries and pools from being closed. So there seems to be this real push, particularly in regional areas, at all levels of government.
Yes, yeah, it's makes it pretty clear where their priorities lie when, you know, there's thousands, hundreds of thousands going towards weapons expos, and, you know, people can't go to the library, or there's no resources at schools and things like that. I guess this kind of brings us to the bit of the kind of the bigger picture of what we've been doing with these interviews over the last few weeks is talking to various kind of socialist candidates and councillors about, you know, kind of the role of socialists in local government. I think a lot of people look at council or local government and think, oh, they just deal with, you know, the typical things like rubbish and roads and things like that. But we've been talking about kind of the bigger role that councillors can play, particularly when you have like an activist socialist person in those positions. So I guess I just wanted to ask how you envision that kind of role of a socialist on council.
Yeah, I think the big one straight up for socialists is opposing any privatisation or outsourcing of council services. And we've seen a lot of this, you know, across all councils. Aged care services are being outsourced. Kinders were outsourced in some councils. Meals on Wheels. Most councils now have, like, outsourced and privatised all their pools. Geelong's lucky. All our pools are still in council hands. But it's just one thing after another. And it's exacerbated that in Victoria, at least, we've got a state government imposed rates cap. So, we don't want to keep increasing rates in a cost of living crisis anyway. But what that rates cap does, it's a downwards pressure on wages and conditions for council employees, and then a downwards pressure on services. And then there's all this cost shifting going on from state and federal governments, mostly from state, onto local councils. So stopping that outsourcing is key. Making sure that local councils and regional areas are some of the biggest employers. So tackling things like casualisation, temp contracts, making sure that our council is an employer of choice in our community and has a good reputation as an employer in our community. And equity is a big one because, people like to throw that word around. Like, we've got social equity frameworks and we're all about equal services, but I've been told by more than one council employee, current and past, that when residents ring in requesting whatever it is, maintenance services, a response, as soon as they say Norlang Cario, there's a direction that's been provided to council staff to deprioritise those requests.
Wow.
And I hear that all the time from residents. Or why would I bother ringing about XYZ because they don't care about us? And to have that confirmed back to me, I was shocked, actually. I was genuinely shocked. So I'm like, oh, maybe we're just imagining this. But it is real. So, when people talk about roads rates and rubbish and we like roll our eyes, like, it is important when you're not getting service, like when your local parks aren't up to scratch, when your streets get flooded because your stormwater drains haven't been maintained, and when you don't have tree canopy coverage. Like, it might seem like basics, but when one suburb gets it and others don't, they are big issues for our community. Mm. And the other thing that I've really learned over the last 15 months on council is that council plays such a huge role in the health and well-being of our community. All the funding for our local sporting clubs, promoting health education in the community, other community programs, like, these are bread and butter basics that, as a mental health worker in acute tertiary mental health, these are the things that keep people well, get people connected into their communities, and all of that stuff is funded by council. And if that goes, where we're going to feel that is on the pointy end of acute tertiary mental health, with, more people really unwell, more people needing hospital admission. So, those services are absolutely critical. And as socialists and activists, anyone progressive being elected onto council, it's our role to protect, defend and extend all of these services.
Awesome. So for people who are either in Geelong or not, who want to find out a bit more about your campaign or follow social media, things like that, how can they find you?
So on Facebook, it's Sarah Hathway for Cario. And if you're on Instagram, it's Sarah for Cario on Insta.
Awesome. Well, I'll put a link to those pages in the description as well, so people can click through on there. Thanks so much for joining us, Sarah. It was great to chat.
Thanks for having me.
And good luck with the campaign. So that's about all we have time for on this week's episode of the Green Left News podcast. So thanks for listening for another week. We've got a few events coming up that we'd like to plug. As we mentioned last week, the Rising Tide blockade of the people's of the world's largest coal port is taking place in November, and check the link in the description for more information about that and how you can get involved. And also, we've got the Borloo Activist Centre launch party. Riley, if you just wanted to mention the details around that one.
So as we mentioned last week, the launch of the Borloo Activist Centre as a kind of cultural space as well as a meeting space, it's going to be on Saturday, the 28th of September at 6 p.m. We've got four great bands lined up. We've got food, we've got drinks. It'll be a really nice time.
Yes, so check the links in the description for those events. And I'd just like to thank Sean Valenzuela for the music that you heard on this episode. You can find his work by going to @littlearcherbeats. And as we said at the beginning, if you could become a supporter at greenleft.org.au/support, plans start from $5 a month and make a massive difference to help us continue producing this podcast and also all the other work that Green Left does. What also helps a lot is if you could share this with your friends or on, you know, social media, leave a review on whatever podcast platform you're leaving, watching this or listening to this on, and leave a like or comment as well if, on YouTube or wherever you're listening. That makes a big difference to help bump us up in the algorithms. So that's all for this week on the Green Left News podcast, and we'll see you next time.
All right. Thanks, everyone. Bye.